emergencies, but what about mental health emergencies? Millions of people suffer from some form of mental illness, so knowing how to identify a mental health crisis is critical. Tonight we're showing you a class teaching people to do that. It's part of our Changing Minds project.
Mental health first aid is equivalent to CPR, but it's for people having an emotional crisis. And you're much more likely to see someone having an emotional crisis than you are to see someone having a coronary.
Brian Dibbs, Director of Public Education at the National Council on Behavioral Health, had the pleasure of taking a mental health first aid course recently.
Well, the key is to have open communication. I think that one of the things we teach in the mental health first aid course is non-judgmental listening. And that's about saying just what you said in the previous segment, which is, I'm concerned about you, I care about you, here's what I've noticed that concerns me.
Okay.
We've never had a mental health. We've never empowered first responders, regular citizens, to get that kind of CPR of mental health training that they would get in any other situation.
In October, on World Mental Health Day, I get trained and certified in mental health first aid and learn how to identify some of the signs of mental illness to help people get the support they need. Classes are open to the general public and the cost is minimal. Today's class includes Shane Phillips. He hopes to better understand his sons with special needs, and medical student Raquel Richardson.
There are different warning signs, and I guess the most important thing I learned today is that it just looks different across the ages. So depression for a youth looks completely different for middle age.
The program is funded through a combination of government and private money, and since 2008, half a million people have completed the course.
Council for Behavioral Health will be training 3 million people in mental health first aid. I went through some of this training a few weeks ago, a shorter version of it, I have to say. But even in that short time, I saw just how useful these tools were. It really gives you the skills you need to identify and ultimately help someone in need. Because you never know when these skills might be useful.
Restoration Ministries started out in
2010, it was kind of a name change. We were doing outreach in Bemidji, been in Bemidji actually for almost 23 years. Doing some outreach in some of the local area trail reports and such, and so we were EPOH at the time. Some of you guys have come out and helped with that ministry back in 2008, 2009. We had 9 different churches involved there. Just a quick history, we made a move in 2010, and I felt the Lord was calling us to start a global prayer ministry. So we had a global prayer ministry, named it Restoration Ministries, and since then, we have evolved into developing and equipping the body of Christ to effectively minister to individuals experiencing mental health difficulties or crisis. So that's a little bit about our history. I want to this is who we are today. Restoration Ministries is the branch of Mental Health USA that is specific to the church. And again, this is just a brief history of who we are and what we do. I established Mental Health USA this past October as a nonprofit organization, and our vision is transforming our nation's traditional approach and treatment of mental illness through education, training, and collaboration. So that's what we're doing now. This is our mission. Our mission is creating caring, supportive communities for individuals living with mental health difficulties and for their families. Just to get you a little bit familiar, you're going to see Restoration Ministry, but you're also going to see Mental Health USA. So I thought I would tell you kind of how these merged and and became one. Mental Health USA offers 3 types of trainings, and we're going to talk about one of those trainings today, Mental Health First Aid. The other trainings, can you all see this? Okay. So we have Mental Health First Aid training, then we have Support Group Leader training. That is a 15-hour intensive pastoral care training class for those in your church, organization, or yourself with your pastor's approval who would like to lead biblical support groups within your church or organization. And then we have First Responders Team training, and that is basically helping organizations, my heart is the church, helping churches and organizations be prepared for a crisis before one happens. We're talking about a mental health crisis specifically. So that includes mental health first aid training and an extra half day training. What do we do if somebody walks in and they are experiencing a crisis? What is our plan? So we're not going to wait until it happens. We're going to be prepared ahead of time. Or if somebody calls on the phone and they're suicidal, what do we do? So this training will help prepare for that. We'd like to, on our website, I want to point these out really quickly. We list some resources. We have the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. I also have a list of resources on the back table that will list all these, so feel free. I've got the big poster board back there in the purple. This, you can call anytime. What happens here is you call this number. This is nationwide. It's 800, and it gets routed to your local crisis line. I believe here it's Thief River, but it goes through Upper Mississippi. So it's 1-800-273-TALK. Just wanted to throw that out there real quick. And then we have the Veterans Crisis Line, Deaf and Hard Hearing Crisis Line, and then we have a Crisis Text Line. So if yourself or somebody you know is having thoughts of suicide or self-harm or just experiencing a crisis, you can text hello to 741-741 and you'll get immediate response. You'll start chatting with someone. So just want to throw that out there. There are some other resources available. But that was basically just a brief introduction of who we are and how we came into being who we are, or doing what I do today. Let me just check the time here. We're good. All right, so as I mentioned, I became certified as an instructor in mental health first aid for adults as well as public safety officials. In my family, we have several public safety officials. I have a nephew who's a cop in Chicago, 2 nephews who are cops in Kentucky, a nephew who is a Chicago firefighter, a nephew who is a Rockford, Illinois firefighter. There's a real need in law enforcement and firefighters and EMS to have this training, not just so that when somebody approaches or they approach somebody who maybe they've gotten a call and somebody was a little bit uneasy with somebody else who maybe is experiencing a mental health difficulty or maybe some psychosis. Sometimes, you know, we call law enforcement. What do we do with this person? You know, we're not sure if they need help, or maybe we're a little scared because there's a stigma around mental illness. So with this, we also train law enforcement, all public safety officials, how to approach that individual, but also within the organizations themselves that are dealing with mental health and crime and all sorts of things, there's an above average percentage of public safety officials that deal with mental health crises themselves. So it also teaches how to identify and respond to a coworker if you're a public safety official, or as church leaders or church participants, how can we, as Tim mentioned today, how can we be that light? How can we minister to people that we come across who maybe experience mental illness? Oftentimes we're not prepared. And so mental health first aid works to prepare us for that. So what is mental health first aid? It's the initial help offered to a person developing a mental health or substance use problem or experiencing a mental health crisis. The first aid is given until appropriate treatment and support are received or until the crisis resolves. So that is what mental health first aid is. I'm going to give you just a brief story, history of our family. I want to point out that mental illness often runs in families and is passed down through the DNA, very much like cancer or heart problems. Okay, so it's a very real biological, physical illness. There are many components that make up the whole person. I mean, we talk about body, right? Your body, your physical body. Then we're talking about your soul, your mind, will, and emotions, right? And then the spiritual. And we know that what affects us in one of those areas, if it's left untreated, will also affect those other areas. So in my family, just a brief history here, is my grandmother's, three of her four children had a severe anxiety disorder. My mother was one of those three. And my mother, not realizing that she was battling mental illness, depression, and anxiety, self-medicated for many, many years. She's now a wonderful prayer warrior and has been for, you know, 30-some-odd years. But she battled addictions due to treating mental illness on her own. My mother has 12 daughters. Six of my mother's 12 daughters live with a severe anxiety disorder. Some of them also have a second diagnosis. So mental illnesses are very common. There's also a spectrum, just very much like the autism spectrum. We have the mild, the moderate, and the severe. So we can be experiencing a mental illness, say depression or anxiety, on a more mild side, or it can be very severe. In its severest form, it is extremely disabling. Chronic mental illness is compared, I'm going to throw out a statistic here. The World Health Organization in 2008 said severe mental illnesses are the most disabling illnesses in the United States. Severe depression is comparable or more disabling to quadriplegia. It took me by surprise when I learned these facts. These are on our government's websites. These aren't something I'm throwing out there. So just to bring that to your attention, that mental illnesses are very disabling, and they're very real. And they do oftentimes run in families and are passed down through the DNA. Out of my mother's 12 daughters, one of the six of the ones that have the mental illness, one of them, my younger sister, Luann, she battled bipolar disorder and was later diagnosed with schizophrenia. Luann's paternal grandmother, so Luann's father, we don't have the same father, was a Vietnam veteran, and he was also an orphan growing up. he lived with PTSD, and he was also exposed to Agent Orange, which we are now linking Agent Orange to many types of mental health difficulties. Are you a veteran, sir?
Yes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. So Luann's dad's mom, so her paternal grandmother, on the birthing table, delivering Luann's dad, something changed in her chemistry, and she was never the same. She was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and back then, many years ago, lived the rest of her life in a mental health institution. So this is just a brief introduction to our family history and how common mental illnesses are. Our Surgeon General says 1 in 4 Americans live with a diagnosed mental illness. 1 in 4. And those are only the ones who have received a diagnosis. Many don't receive a diagnosis because we don't want that label. We don't want to be labeled with the mass shooters or those crazy people. So, and we'll talk about later on, that's really the, you can also find this on our Surgeon General's website and the National Doctors' websites. Out of those 1 in 4 individuals that live with a mental illness, less than 4% commit violent crimes. Less than 4% of those living with severe mental illness commit violent crimes. And those that do, it's usually aimed at their caregivers or an object because they're afraid. Maybe they think TV's talking to them or putting thoughts in their mind. There's something going on there, and so they may exhibit violent tendencies. But just keep that in mind as we move along. So with all of this, Luann actually attempted suicide 3 times in her life. The first time at the age of 16, she was rescued just within moments of being pregnant. And then 2 other times. In 2015, I received a phone call from my sister, older sister, with devastating news that Luann had completed suicide. And this is something that we're going to talk about just a little bit later. This was something that was very much preventable. However, nobody in my family knew at that time, and I wasn't aware of what she was going through until after that. Nobody knew how to respond when she was reaching out for help, and she was stating that this was her intention. So this is one of the reasons I'm doing what I'm doing. But really, it wasn't until our own child was diagnosed with a mental illness. And the journey that we've been on with our child, that's what really served to open our eyes to the 1 in 4 individuals in the United States living with a mental health difficulty. Sometimes, you know, you just don't know it, you don't understand it unless you live it. With that came leaving our home twice within a 3-year period, looking for help and support for our child. So we left our home in one state, moved to another state because we weren't receiving answers, we weren't getting help we needed. We felt very much alone. We just wanted help for our child. Went to another state because we were down there visiting and our child was hospitalized. Finally receiving the help that was needed. Recovered great. He's put on a medication regimen, recovered great. A couple years later, weaned him off meds, thinking maybe this was more of a spiritual issue. Our fault. and he relapsed. So today he's doing great, and it's one of the things that we teach with mental health first aid is that recovery is possible. It is very possible, but we're not going to be able to do it on our own. We need other people in our lives. We need support systems. So as we go into that, I just wanted to also mention that I'm going to talk about what participants learn in mental health first aid. So when you take this course, it's an 8-hour course. It's really originally was a 12-hour course. And for the sake of making it happen in one day for a lot of organizations, the National Council of Behavioral Health is the ones that do mental health first aid. They're the ones that train instructors, they write the curriculum. Oh, you've heard Michelle Obama talk about them. They wanted to get this in, you know, into, condense it to 8 hours so that organizations can actually fit this in. They can take a day and train their employees. So I actually like to do it in 10 hours if I can, 2 days, because I like to have breaks and lunches. Otherwise you're falling asleep by the end of the day. So we're going to learn risk factors, warning signs of mental health and substance use problems. Those who take the course will learn information and get information on depression, anxiety, trauma, psychosis, and substance use. What's not mentioned here is suicide. You're also going to get a lot of information on suicide, how to assess for risk of suicide, and how to intervene should you see that there is a risk there. And you're going to learn here a 5-step action plan to help someone who is developing a mental health problem or crisis. Okay, we're going to talk about that here in a second. You're also going to learn about available evidence-based professional peer and self-help resources in your local community. I have a resource list there. It is by no way an exhaustive list, but it's just a few of the resources that we have here in town. There are many more. I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide here. Okay, so the Mental Health First Aid Action Plan, we're going to look at these letters. If you look down this way, it's spelled LG. And if you look in the corner, there's a little koala over there. I actually have a stuffed bear sitting on my resource table. They named this koala bear LG. Okay, and it's a koala bear because Mental Health First Aid started in Australia and came to the United States in 2008. So every letter of LG's name stands for one of the steps, one of the 5 steps on how we take action to help somebody in need. And the very first one, and this is probably the most important, keep in mind these don't have to be done in order, but A is for assess for risk of suicide or harm. How do we do that? How do we, when we know or we think maybe there's a crisis here, is this person thinking about killing themselves? If so, what do we do? Oftentimes we don't know what to do. As I mentioned, my sister was reaching out for help. The cries for help were all around her, yet not a single one of my family knew how to help. Okay, so we're gonna offer through this course some very practical ways to help, and the very first thing is to assess. Does anybody know any of the risk factors? Just shout them out really quickly. What are some risk factors for suicide?
Withdrawn behavior.
I'm sorry?
Withdrawn behavior.
Withdrawn behavior? Could be, yeah, definitely.
Or the opposite even, it's a change in behavior.
A change in behavior. Okay, so a radical change in behavior. So maybe the person has been very depressed and for a long time, and they've noted that, and now all of a sudden they seem kind of happy. Everything's okay. Why do you think that they might seem okay all of a sudden?
Manic phase.
Manic? What else?
They've come up with a plan to execute
their... Exactly. They've got a plan now. They've got a plan. So again, I'm not going to be able to spend a lot of, as much, I mean 8 hours, I've got to condense into, you know, 30 minutes, but they have a plan in place. So now what do we do? You know, we need to find out, have they collected the things that they need? One of the very first things we do is we come right out and ask them, not are you thinking about hurting yourself, because that's a whole different thing, but are you thinking about killing yourself? And how do we respond to that? Why might that be important to come out and ask the question directly? Anybody know? It's scary to ask it. It's like,
It's important to ask directly because it forces a response. Even if it's like, if the person, you can't control if somebody lies to you. But it does force a response. And if you don't ask directly, if you say, well, I'm not hurting myself, that's like, if you ask hurting, then you're just like, yeah. So it forces a response.
Yeah. And what that does when we do that is it really lets the secret out, because our secrets make us sick. What we hold inside makes us sick. We are created to expel. You know, everybody sits on the toilet, right? This is a way our, but emotionally the same thing. We are created to expel, and we need a safe place to do that. And when I say a safe place, I'm talking about safe people. So mental health first aid will teach you how to be that safe person for another person and also help that person to get the help that they need. And then we're going to look at any questions on ASSESS really quickly. Again, this isn't comprehensive. This is just a quick overview. It's kind of pretty much out there, but what would that look like? If you ask somebody, are you thinking about killing yourself? And they say, yes. And we go, ooh, what have we just done? We kind of shut that person off. If we have our nonverbal and verbal communication can shut that person down. And as we see in the video, we want that person to open up. We want to draw them out. It's in those moments of isolation that most people take their last breaths and make that decision. So by getting your secrets out and you being able to listen and be that safe place, we're now getting them out of isolation. And what better place to be but into the loving arms of the body of Christ, right? Christ in us, through us, listening. So listening non-judgmentally is very important. What would be an example of judgmental listening? Anybody want to throw something out there?
Just stop it.
Say stop it. Can't do that. No, you're not doing it. The fastest way to shut somebody down. But what we can offer is that listening ear. And we can, when people know that they're safe and they've been able to express what they're going through and maybe even what their plan is, it also is kind of like letting a boiling pot of tea, right, or water, and you kind of let the lid off a little bit and kind of let some steam out, it kind of just might be enough to have them change their mind. Okay? Kind of cool things down just a little bit.
Clarifying question for that. How do you listen in such a way that doesn't, I guess, reinforce where they're at? Because I think for some people, seeing someone else's jaw drop might think, oh, they're not okay with this idea of mine to take my life.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Right. And we definitely don't want them to think we're okay with the idea. And that's a very good question. You're going to have to take the course to get the more but I'll try to answer that the best I can in here. As we go through these steps, we're going to learn how do we engage that person or how to engage that person in making a choice to receive help. Okay? So as you're listening, you're not condoning what you're doing, but you're identifying, you're empathizing. Everybody knows the difference between sympathy and empathy. Empathy is you're putting yourself in their shoes. You're allowing yourself to experience and feel what this person is experiencing and feeling so that you can come alongside them and help them take a different path. Okay? One of the things that is inevitable that we're not going to save everybody's life. You know, some people, regardless of the help we give, will still die by suicide. But as the body of Christ, and as that empathetic listener, okay, we want to be able to take this in a different direction, in a healthy direction. And part of that is the very next step. Does that help answer your question? Okay. So the next step is to give reassurance and information. We're going to reassure the person. Well, we hear this all the time. You're not alone. Okay? You're not alone. What does that look like? Reassurance. Go ahead.
Sitting down. With them, just sitting down.
Sitting down with them. Being with them. Having somebody else there. Presence is huge. As a chaplain, the ministry of presence is probably the largest part of the ministry of a chaplain. Just being there for someone. It brings comfort, support, hope. And this is what we're called to do as the body of Christ, right? To bring comfort, support, and hope to others, especially those who are facing a crisis. And information. We're going to, who do they know that has helped them before? Maybe find that contact information or and put that in their hands. Maybe it's a card, somebody that's hanging on their fridge and you're there at their home. Maybe you can say, can I give you this information, this number? Can you keep this handy? And we're going to get into, you know, encourage appropriate professional help and the other ones. But really, giving that information is also what resources are out there. And I showed you a brief list of resources from my website. And there are a ton of resources, but we want to give good information. There's a lot of not so good information. Believe it or not, there are ways to prevent suicide on Google. Okay? So we want to make sure what we give people is actually helpful information. And then encourage appropriate professional help. What do we got here till 9:40? Is it or 10:40? Okay. 10:40, right? Okay. So encourage appropriate professional help. What are some professional help people that we've heard of? People in the mental health profession, or just even outside the mental health profession, that would be that we can encourage this. Any like doctors?
Psychologists.
Preachers.
Pastors.
And I would say, yeah, that would be okay. Psychiatrists are special, those that specialize in mental health. So in the area of the brain, okay? We're gonna encourage this. And then lastly, we are gonna encourage self-help and other support strategies. Self-help, what would that be? Anybody? Maybe taking a walk, getting some exercise. Again, we're not looking at just suicide here. We're looking at depression, anxiety, trauma, psychosis, non-suicidal self-injury. But these steps will remain the same. They're just a little bit different for each of those categories. And in Mental Health First Aid, you're going to learn how to apply these steps for depression and anxiety, how to apply these steps for suicide, how to apply these steps for non-suicidal self-injury. That makes sense. So what are some other self-help and support strategies that we can encourage here? Anybody?
Counseling, yeah.
And that would fall probably under the professional health, but it's still, how about books? You know, I've heard the story of somebody who was diagnosed with bipolar disorder and ended up in the hospital, and their pastor came and brought them a book called Bipolar for Dummies. I mean, you don't know anything about your diagnosis, how can you help yourself, right? So encourage that type of help.
Is there support groups?
Thank you so much. Support groups are huge.
So would it have to be a certain kind of support group for that specific, like bipolar only, or?
You know, there are a variety of support groups out there. You certainly wouldn't want to send somebody that's dealing with mental health issues to a divorce care support group if they're not going through a divorce. Mm-hmm. If they're dealing with mental health issues because they're dealing with grief, this prolonged grief can actually change your brain chemistry if it's not sought, if you don't seek help for it. Maybe a grief share support group. But my heart or passion, and as I mentioned, is getting support groups in our churches. Let's train leaders to run a support group for somebody living with anxiety and depression, or somebody maybe like my family who has suffered the loss of someone through suicide. What better person to lead these groups than somebody with a lived experience? So say I have lost a loved one to suicide. I could lead a group in my church for survivors of suicide loss. If you live with depression and anxiety, why not lead a support group for people living with depression and anxiety? Because who can better relate than you yourself? So that is one of the requirements that we have for our support group leaders, is you must have a lived experience and health of your own. NAMI, anybody heard of NAMI? National Association of Mental Illness? NAMI offers support groups and support group leader training that is not faith-based, but they are also looking for people to lead support groups, and they'll actually, I think, pay for gas to go down to the cities to get trained. Any other questions on this before we move on? We're good? Okay. So, why mental health first aid? Mental health problems are common. Learn how to notice when someone needs help. Stigma is associated with mental health problems. So, as a first aider, you promote understanding, and that helps break down that stigma. I'm not sure if I mentioned this, you're probably already aware, but the stigma is often, it's usually the thing that keeps people from seeking help. And then oftentimes they end up getting to a place of crisis. So as a first aider, if we can begin to recognize when somebody might be developing a mental health difficulty or is in crisis, and we're able to come alongside that person and offer understanding, we're helping to break that stigma. It's okay to seek help. It's okay to see a mental health professional. We can even encourage that. Professional help is not always on hand. This is pretty disheartening, but we have a severe nationwide shortage of psychiatrists. Many psychiatrists are doing televisits through a computer because this is what we have in our nation. Anybody thinking about going into the medical professional field? Psychiatry needs you. So encourage by, trained in mental health first aid, you're encouraging community members to support one another. Individuals with mental health problems often do not seek help, and we talked about that. We talked about the stigma. Sometimes they don't even realize that what they're dealing with isn't the normal because they've always dealt with it. I had a niece who was talking about her doctor. I'm like, when did you know that you needed a doctor? Or when did you know that you needed medicine? Or she goes, it wasn't until I seen a doctor and got medicine that I realized everything else up until now wasn't normal. This is the first time I feel normal and I feel healthy. And she's, I think, 23 years old. So her whole life she lived with an anxiety disorder and didn't realize it. Many people are not well informed and don't know how to respond. I mentioned my sisters, myself. When our child was experiencing mental health difficulty and he asked questions, deep theological questions, I had no clue how to help. I had no clue what he was dealing with. So being trained in mental health first aid will really help you to intervene, and it might even save a life. Okay, so four reasons to become a mental health first aider. Be prepared. Just like you learn CPR, you learn how to help somebody in a mental health or substance use crisis. Mental illnesses are common. One in five people will experience a mental illness in a given year. Currently, one in four Americans live with a mental illness, but one in five people will develop a mental illness this year. Number three, you care. Be there for a friend, a family member, a colleague, somebody in your church, somebody at Walmart, just a stranger. Be there. Learn how to recognize the signs and know how to respond. Panic attacks are covered. Sometimes we see panic attacks in a busy, crowded place like Walmart. How do we know if that's a panic attack or what this person is going through? You can be there as a first aider and you can train. And you can help. People with mental illnesses suffer alone oftentimes. I mentioned our family suffered alone. I forgot to mention that, when we weaned our child off medication, and we couldn't get him back on, we left our home again. This is the second time within a three-year period, seeking help and support in another state. We moved back to Bemidji after being gone 3 years. It's like a small town, maybe there's no resources there in our minds. There wasn't the resources we were looking for, but it's a smaller community, and at this point, we just need to keep the person safe. The whole idea was we felt alone. We didn't feel like we had the support. Our child was alone in this. But as first aiders, we can be that source of help and support for somebody else. But it starts with getting trained and learning how to recognize it. So for sake of time here, this is a program overview. You're going to learn in the class. You will learn what mental health first aid is. That mental health problems in America. I mentioned 1 in 4. Mental health first aid action plan, which we just went over. LG. You're going to learn about how to understand depression and anxiety. Mental health first aid action plan specifically applied for depression and anxiety, for suicidal thoughts and behavior, for symptoms of depression, and for non-suicidal self-injury. And in session 2, which is the second half of the class, you will learn the action plan for anxieties. We're going to look at specifically panic attacks. These are very interactive classes too, so there's a lot of up and down and exercises, so it's pretty fun. And traumatic events, symptoms of anxiety, and then we're going to go into understanding psychosis. And the mental health first aid action plan for psychosis, and then for disruptive or aggressive behavior. And then lastly, we're going to look at substance use disorders and the mental health, applying the mental health first aid action plan for overdose, withdrawal, and substance use disorders. And lastly, we bring it all together and do an exercise in using your mental health first aid action plan. This is who we're reaching. There are over 1 million first aiders in the United States. And these are some of the dark blue areas are 0.3% or more of the population that are trained. So you see Minnesota is the lighter blue, and that is 0.2 to 0.29% of Minnesotans are trained in mental health first aid. It also says that we have 144 instructors in this state alone. Who we're reaching, 23.5% other. These are people who are being trained. 1.9% are business corporations. 3.3% are faith communities. These are old slides too, so these probably will be updated in the next year. 11.7% of law enforcement or public safety. That is like our largest population that we're training. 3% primary care. 10.43% social services. In the two classes I just held, we had many people that were in social work that come out and took the class. 9.2% of higher education, and 6.78% behavioral health, 30% of the general community, not specified. So these are the people that are being trained in mental health first aid. My heart, my call is to bring awareness to the church, to the body of Christ, to help train and equip you in mental health first aid. Because research studies show that when most people are developing a mental health difficulty or experience a crisis, where's the first place they turn to? Usually the first place they turn to, anybody know?
Church.
It's their church or somebody of faith that they know. And yet, I know I didn't get that training when I went through Bible school. You know, we're not prepared. So again, look at the brochure if you'd like some training for your church or organization, wherever you work, get a hold of me. I think we are about done here, but let's see. I wanted to really quickly if it'll work, I'm going to try to play this one. If you have any questions, you can see me at the table. This is about 3 minutes.
Psychiatry and the church. it confused me because your brain is an organ that can have problems, just like your heart. I grew up in the church, but I didn't hear these things addressed. And so I love the idea that we can be honest about the hard stuff. If we didn't have hope when it came to breast cancer, if we didn't have hope when it came to HIV/AIDS, we would not be seeing the progress and the promise in healthcare that we see today. And I think when it comes to suicide and suicide prevention, we need that same hope.
There's so much hope in knowing that God has a plan, and that plan is greater than any addiction that you might wrestle with.
Their nature of these disorders is it affects people deep inside their souls. There are many marginalized groups, but people who are suffering silently because of their mental illness and addictions, they need to have someone reach out to them.
1 in 5 children suffer from a mental health disorder during their lifetime, and it's so important to know and be aware of that as a parent. Also know is something like less than a third of kids actually get treatment.
And mental illness is not a lifelong death sentence. Recovery is possible.
The only time we talk about mental health is when there is a terrible mass shooting, a terrible tragedy. I think Christians underestimate what we can be to another person. Psychiatry and the church should be working hand in hand. That's actually when it works most efficiently.
We're so used to wanting to do things alone and in our own strength and power, and it is very, very tough. Hold on and let people help you.
There are places of hope, and when you have hope, you can also bring yourself to bring healing.
We get to watch the light bulb go off when people realize they're not alone, they don't have to feel alone, that it is okay to be honest, that it is okay to ask for help. These are not bad people who did bad things. These are folks who have a disease, and that we, as a community, really have an obligation to our most vulnerable citizens.
We have to train folks, our professionals, our ministers, our pediatricians, our school teachers. No matter where you are, reach out and look at the other people or the other organizations, churches, synagogues, doesn't matter, and get started.
The church needs to stand up. And now that we understand and debunk the myth of depression and suicide leading one inevitably to hell, of course, we're mature enough theologically, and we understand it's not factual. Now it behooves us to stand up, to go beyond prayer.
This conference today about acceptance and connection and compassion, that is what's missing in the field.
All the messages that a soldier needs to hear more than anything is in service of your country, for whatever act you've had to do, whether it was right or wrong, God still loves you, no matter what.
The greatest lie of the enemy is that brokenness will sever relationship. And I would say, it's not your fault. It's not about your spiritual life. This is treatable. There is hope. And all you have to do is just take the first step.
Any questions, feel free to